The one time I need to get somewhere by a certain time to meet Jordo and the boys, and all this happens. See some wild Australian bush tucker, some wild plant food over here in Australia. Well, this tree here is a nonda plum, and I'm just driving past. I'm in Cape York, far north Queensland, and I just spotted this tree, and it's absolutely loaded. Have a look at that. These fruits here are called a nonda plum, and they taste just like, well, not just like a regular plum, but similar to a regular plum. They're just a bit drier, and they leave a bit of a funny taste in your mouth. But the indigenous tribes in this area would get the seed out of it, ground it all up, get a whole lot of them, ground them all up and make like a porridge, you know, for breakfast or whatever. But the ones that you want to eat aren't the ones on the tree. The ones you want to eat are on the ground here. So you want to try and find a nice soft one. Nice soft one like this one. You want to beat the bugs to them. Oh, that's perfect. And there you go. See, it's really white and flowery, so it's a lot drier than a regular plum, but absolutely delicious. So that's an nonda plum. Welcome back to another episode. Like I said, we're in Cape York, far north Queensland. We're cutting through the Cape today, heading south, southwest from where I was, Lockhart River, Aboriginal community on the east coast of Cape York, and I'm heading down to Normanton to catch up with Jordan. You'll remember Jordo from last season. He loves his barramundi fishing as much as I do, so I'm cutting down to see him, but I have to cross one of the biggest rivers in Cape York, the Mitchell River. I'm about 200 kilometres away from the Mitchell River right now, and I'm hoping I can cross it. It's still really early in the season, so we'll see. We're heading down there now. Catch up with Jordo, and then we're going to go out on country somewhere for a couple of days chasing some big barramundi. So stick around. This episode's going to be a cracker. On the way to this bloody river crossing, I've just stopped to do a routine check around the car. I always grab my tyres and give them a bit of a shake, check those bearings, and this driver's side was super loose, so I thought, all right, I just got to repack them. As I pulled it all apart, I realised they don't just need repacking. The bearings are actually shot. So you can see in here, that rear bearing is absolutely cactus. But luckily it's happened before, you know, something really bad has happened where the cold bearing shot out and the tide. There was actually this road back in season two. On this road, I did exactly that, threw a set of bearings. The wheel must have wobbled that much that the tire hit the guard and ripped the tire to shreds. And I spent the night on the side of the road fixing stuff, because it wasn't as simple as what it sounds. You have to go back and watch that episode. That was a bit of chaos. So luckily this has happened before it's gone too bad. I've got a spare set of bearings in the boat. So I'm going to get the tools out, knock the bearings out of this hub, put the new bearings in there, grease her up, and I should be on the road in 15 minutes. All your rubbish, put it in a bag, and get yourself one of these bin bags on the back of your ute or your trailer and take it to the next town. All right, just found another one. There's heaps of these flowering at the moment. Now trust me, we're gonna get to Jordo and we're gonna go barra fishing. But I just wanted to show you guys this stuff because I find it really cool. Now there's heaps of this flowering at the moment. This is a wattle, acacia. This one here, see these beautiful yellow flowers. Now, the indigenous tribes would use these for food. There's like a sticky resin that oozes out. I can't see anyone on this one. I think you gotta peel the bark back, but it's really sweet. So they'd use that as a food. You can eat that, and it's almost like a lolly, really tasty. But this timber is also extremely hard. So the indigenous tribes back in the old days would cut off a section and split it with a stone axe and shape it for a spear tip. Now, these days, and for the last sort of 250 years through trade, through all sorts of things, indigenous tribes got their hands on steel. So steel spear tips were obviously a lot more efficient. But back in the day before steel, here in Australia, the wattle trees were the perfect spear tip. So it's a very, very useful tree, and I'm passing so much of it through here. And it is flowering, so something is in season that the indigenous tribes back in those old days would have been hunting and using that as a signal. All right, here's another little gem. Now this tree here, whoa, it's looking very snaky. Gotta get up through this grass. There we, obviously here in Australia we have some very deadly snakes, you know, being brown snake and the taipan are two of the worst. And this environment here is exactly what they love. Long, dry grass, fallen trees, things like that, where I am always extremely careful. But this tree here is a Cooktown ironwood, this fella here. And you can see, that's another one there next to it. You can see it almost has scales, like crocodile scales. And the leaves are almost round and very dark green on the top and the bottom. So the trees kind of stand out. But the Cooktown ironwood, I'm gonna get out of the grass here and then talk. The Cooktown ironwood is used, well, was used by, again, the indigenous tribes of this area, but a lot of this is a huge area where we find Cooktown ironwood up here in Cape York. The trees were used, was actually the roots that were used. For one of the purposes of this tree was the indigenous tribes would dig up the roots, cut off small parts of the root, like with a stone axe, and then over a fire, they would roll the bark, because the bark would heat up and then come off onto a separate stick. They would roll it off onto a stick and it would be like this big, thick, black tar that would end up going rock hard. And then they would apply that to the spear shaft to bind the spear tip into the shaft. So that was a very, very important thing to have. And I imagine a lot of the men would carry around some kind of dilly bag or something, which they would have probably a stone axe in there, in like a hair belt. And in their dilly bag, they would have maybe a couple of shards of rock that they would use as a knife. They would have a stick with a lot of that Cooktown ironwood rolled onto a stick, ready to go, ready to make a spear. All sorts of like day-to-day necessities would be in this dilly bag. And that tree there is the source of one of those necessities. Now, it's also white ant resistant. White ants hate this tree. So a lot of the indigenous probably used it as well for building their humpies, but a lot of the pioneers that came up here to Cape York to start cattle stations would have used these trees for fence posts, for posts within the homes that they were building, because the white ants won't touch it. So very, very handy tree. And you can see there's a lot of them around here. So at this point, I should explain to you all that I told my wife 24 hours ago that I'd call her to check in the next few hours. So that was yesterday, right? I'm traveling through the middle of Cape York, heading south, and I'd planned to stay in this little, just outside this little community where I know there's full reception. But I'd forgotten, you know, I'd been in the bush for so long, I'd forgotten that it's actually school holidays. So as I come through this little community, it's full of people, full of campers, caravans and all that, and I just kept going camp on the side of the road somewhere. Now, my satellite phone's broken. I'd forgotten to call my wife, and she's starting to get concerned. And the last time we spoke, I'd said I'd be arriving to Jordo on this afternoon. So technically, I've got a couple of hours to travel a further 300 kilometers on dirt roads. That's if this river is passable.
I'm starting to doubt if we're gonna make it there today. This track is slow going. Some parts you get up to like 80 k's an hour, and then you slow down to 20 k's an hour. Constantly these washouts. And then we're still not at the big river crossing. Here we go. Here we go, here's some speed. Well, there goes the guard.
All right, we're looking at that. That's a cocky gate made of barbed wire. And I'd say that is there because I'm very close. I'm 19 kilometers from the main Mitchell River crossing, and I have heard that it's not open. I thought I'd push down here anyway and just have a look. But I know that there's a bypass, or I've been told there's a bypass further east, which is a lot of backtracking for me, but I've never been on that road. I've never done that crossing. So I'm excited. I'm always excited to try new tracks. But I thought we'd be able to get down there to the river. I'd be able to show you guys, send the drone over it, see if it is passable. But yeah, let's scoot over to this bypass road and see if there's a sign that says more. I don't really want to open that up. The reason I don't want to open it up is because you're cutting through cattle stations out here. You're meant to stay on the road and follow the signs, right? If they're saying that a road is shut, then it's shut. There's also a sign here, I'll show you now, pointing to the bypass, which is like 100 metres before that barbed wire fence. Now that's telling you to go, this way. I've got a hell of a rattle back there. I've got to suss out what's happening with my trailer. Broken a spring. All right, guys, who is coming to Cape York? One of you are coming to Cape York with me. We're gonna draw it later in the year, but this is gonna be the absolute trip of a lifetime, and it's all paid for by Wild Reaches, by myself. We're gonna pick you up from your door, wherever you are in Australia, fly you up to Cape York, meet up with me out there in the wilderness and probably one of my mates from one of the communities. You're gonna be living off the land, basically. We're gonna be doing the whole Wild Reaches experience, you know, pushing the tinny, eating barramundi, you know, dodging crocodiles, sleeping in the trees in our hammocks, cooking on the fire, breakfast, lunch and dinner, and learning a whole lot about Aboriginal culture and living off the land, just like you see me do in the episodes. Now, all you need to do is go to wildreaches.com, follow the prompts there, and fill in all your details, choose what tier you want to be in, and it could be you on the next Wild Reaches episode. Snap to leaf spring. Damn it. This bloody road's caused some carnage. I find a spot in the shade and I got a spare spring in the boat. I'll have to fix that up. Because that spring has now flattened out, it's reduced my clearance from the guard to the tire. And you can see the guard has now ripped the edge of that tire all the way around. That's just shredding my tire, so I've got to find shade and fix that straight away. Oh man, this is the second time I've been on this road, and both times now there's been carnage. Alright, so what's going on here is I've got the old spring. Now that thing is very worse for wear, but it's actually okay. It's going to do the job. It's going to get me down to Normanton. As long as the other one doesn't snap on the other side, then in Normanton, I'll straight away I'll order a new set if I can't find any there, order some to town from Cairns, and I'll go out bush, catch some big barra with Jordo. When I get back, they should be there for the next stint of the trip. But what's going on here? I need to lift the trailer enough to get the wheel off the ground. Then take the wheel off, which will take, the jack's gonna take the load of the whole trailer off the spring so that I can remove the spring. But that's the jack, fully extended. So I've got a couple of options here. I either reverse up to that tree and try to run a strap around the trailer up to the tree, ratchet it up and lift the weight that way. Or I get the chainsaw out, cut a piece of timber, piece of tree, a short stump to be able to extend my jack. Or, very simple option, is use my treads, which will take the weight of a whole vehicle, 4 ton at least, and I should be able to sit the jack over those four studs there underneath there and lift the whole thing. Thank you to Treads. Perfect moment. This whole season is brought to you guys by Treads. They're recovery tracks, right? If you leave home without a set of recovery tracks, you've got rocks in your head. These things have saved my ass so many times. In fact, the other day I was set up at camp. I was parked up on my Treads to level out the car. Went four-wheel drive into a fishing spot with the boys in Yarrabah. I got so bogged trying to get the boat in the water and I didn't have my Treads. It's the second time that I haven't had recovery tracks with me when I'm completely bogged, and I just wish more than anything I had them, because I had to winch out. I got out, but these things just make it easy. Before I do anything, before I pull the winch out, before I let my tires down, all that, I use Treads, because they just lift your car up and out. They're absolutely amazing. So thank you to Treads for sponsoring the season. Thank you for believing in what I'm doing up here, and I really rate your gear. This is my first season actually using Treads, the brand of Treads. I've always used recovery tracks, but not Treads, and I love them. I reckon they're absolutely amazing, so I can recommend them to you guys. They'll stand up against anything else on the market. If not, they'll be better, I promise. They're great. So get yourself a set of Treads, Australian made. Look at that.
All right, back to the episode. Let's get these Treads down.
Off their tread mounting bracket. The one time I need to get somewhere by a certain time to meet Jordo and the boys, and all this happens. I think it's about 3 o'clock. I've got to backtrack now to cross this Mitchell River. It could be hours. And then I know from the other side of the Mitchell, right here, 20 kilometers away, the other side of there, down to where I'm going, is about 5 hours, depending on the road. So best case, I've still got 7 hours to go. It's gonna be a late night. Yeah, look at this. That's gonna work a treat. That wheel's off the ground. Had to use four treads. Take this wheel off. Put it under there for extra safety. Now we need to take the spring off. All right, so you got your four nuts over your two U-bolts. You even on, yep. And the one big bolt through the end here. Now you need to have a shifter for every occasion, all different size shifters out here on the road, and a good set of sockets. Nice long sockets. I'm sorry, a lot of you have just probably clicked on this for the fishing, and it's just been bloody bush tucker and dramas on the road all morning. But that's life up here. You want to go fishing up here in the Gulf of Carpentaria, this is what's going to happen, you know, and hopefully we're rewarded at the end of it with a couple of really nice big barra. There you go. Snapped spring. Now that is useless. Out with the old, you can see that snapped, absolutely buggered, absolutely useless. And back in with the old. But it should get me out of trouble for a little while. All right, we're off again. Looking at the map, I think we have about a two-hour detour, because that river is the crossing's no good. So yeah, about a two-hour detour. I just bumped into an old couple who crossed the river up here up ahead. So this mythical crossing that I'd never heard of before is indeed there. And as you can see here, these signs, one says Musgrave that way, the way I just came from. That sign says Normanton that way, but the crossing is completely unpassable. So we're gonna head up here. Now, everything's back together. I put the spare tire on, so I'm not gonna have any trouble with that tire. And hopefully these springs get me to Normanton. It's 4:40 p.m. so Barclays if we're getting there tonight, I reckon. Thank you.
Well, just when this day couldn't get any bigger, any harder, it's about 7:30 at night. I've crossed the Mitchell River like you guys saw, and I've completely torn apart this side of the trailer. It's buckled. The guard has been ripped off. The tire's flat. I'll have to assess it, see if I've actually done a bead or ripped the tire apart. But the spring is still on. Look at this. I don't know what's going on. So the spring is still mounted on there. Yeah, there you go. The tire is ripped to shreds. The axle has slipped right back somehow. And the other U-bolt's gone, which I had spring washers on. That's strange, but I've had enough. It is, like I said, 7:30. I can't even crawl this thing off the road. I don't know how I'm gonna, I can't be bothered fixing it right now. Oh man, I'm on the road, I can't camp here. I just hit a big bloody bull dust hole back there and I felt the trailer bounce right up in the air, and then this happened. All right, I'm gonna try jack it up and get that axle back under the center of the spring. Change the tire, rip that guard completely off, and find a camp for the night. The things I do, eh? Things I do. I've had enough. Alright, so as you all know, I'm out here on my own, which at times like this sucks. You know, it's probably 8 o'clock at night, and shit has hit the fan. It's always handy to have someone with you at times like this, even just for moral support, you know, someone to be helping, bouncing ideas off each other, and this is what I choose to do. I love dropping in to the communities and catching up with mates along the way, and being solo allows me to do that. So that's why I'm here. That's why I'm solo. I've worked out what's happened. This axle is meant to have a locator plate mounted on here, which has a hole in it. Now I can feel where the weld was. And that locator locates the underside of this pin. So that's what's happened. We've hit a big bump. Maybe these had loosened up on the track very slightly, just enough for that bump to throw that out of place. And it's gone. So what I need to do is go and find it. Luckily I pulled up real quick because I felt all this happen. There's a big dust hole back down there. I'm gonna go look for that plate. But even with that plate, without it being welded to the axle, it's basically doing stuff all. But if I can find it, bolt this whole thing back together, use two ratchet straps. I'll strap one going forward from the axle and one going back from the axle, pulling in both directions to hold it hopefully in place. And I'm just gonna have to crawl all the way to Normanton and get someone down there to weld this locating plate back in place, and get two new springs and replace the springs on the trailer, get these guards welded back on, and hopefully I'm good to go. Look what I've found. I just walked, it was probably 150, 200 meters down the road there, just following my tire tracks, and just found this huge bull dust hole, big long bull dust hole. And if you guys know bull dust, you could drop a rock in it and it's going to go like 300 mil deep. And as soon as I saw it, I was like, there's no way I'm going to find this. Took like another 5 steps and here it is, right on the top. So that's going to save my ass. I'm actually going to put this back on and
tie wire this to the axle, which will help a little bit. Don't know what else I got. See what else I can come up with, but tie wire and duct tape, fucking everything, to the axle, and then do that strap idea, like I said, and keep pushing on to Normanton.
How cool was that? I didn't realise we were so close to the Mitchells. That river you just saw was the Mitchell River. Plenty of big barramundi in that river. The Mitchell River basically cuts Cape York in half. Goes right across to the east coast into the Great Dividing Range and comes right across huge big river mouth north of Kawanyama. It's actually two river mouths just north of Kawanyama on the west coast in the Gulf of Carpentaria. Yeah, pretty cool, but good morning, guys. So things are pretty bad, I'm not gonna lie, but I'm just really concentrating on one problem at a time. Fix that problem and then on to the next. But last night was just a debacle, as you probably saw. It was literally just on the side of the road over here, and I couldn't drive any further, which I'll show you in a sec. So I've just done a U-turn, got myself off the road. Only one car passed us last night, which was about 4 a.m. I reckon a car passed. Actually no, one car passed when I was working on the trailer too at about 8:30, 9 o'clock, something like that. And then one at about 4 a.m. So where are we? We are about halfway to Normanton. It took me all day yesterday and I did 337 kilometers. We still have 300 kilometers to go on these tracks, so it's not going to get any easier. I'm down to no spare tire for the trailer because, as you saw, I've completely shredded the tire. I'll try and show you that. There's no repairing that tire, so I don't have a spare. But the big problem is I got it all back together last night. I got it all back up under there. I've duct taped that mounting plate. I thought about tire wire, but the tire wire would have got in the way of the spring. So I've wrapped it like 20, 30 times in duct tape. And I'm still going to do the two straps just to hold that axle in position. But this is the big problem. This tire is rubbing on the frame of the trailer. And the other tire is well off the trailer. It was like, so last night I'm looking at it, it was all twisted and I couldn't work out why. Have a look at this. See that big bend? There's a big bend in the trailer. And a crack starting here at the back. But I have a plan to fix this. Been thinking about it all night. And the plan is to, but I'm not gonna tell you guys what that plan is in case it doesn't work. No, I'm not gonna tell you what it is, you're gonna have to watch. Let's get into it.
So by now, my wife Mel has had a sleepless night. Worst case scenario is flowing through her mind. And by daybreak, she's contacting everyone who knows me well and this country well that I'm traveling through, asking for their assistance. I'm talking pastoral stations, all my mates, helicopter pilots, even the police are on alert waiting for more information. And meanwhile, I'm unaware and I'm just working systematically on fixing the problems in front of me like I normally would. Thank you.
right, here's the plan. I've got the Sherpa winch out, running all my Sabre gear. So I've got a Sabre 2.5 or 3 meter, what's that called? Extreme utility rope. That thing's bloody awesome for tow. Anyway, I won't get into that. Utility rope around the tree, coming down to a shackle and a pulley, pulley block, recovery ring, whatever you want to call it these days. So that's a Sabre recovery ring. So that's gonna come out of the winch, around the recovery ring, down here to this tree. Same thing, big soft shackle to another recovery ring to the trailer. Now I have cut this bit of log here, mounted it right where there's a cross member on the trailer, which is also the mounting point for the front of the spring. So that's the last point on the trailer from the drawbar back that is actually still good. So I've cut this log through here, duct taped it to the tree, just to hold it there until the pressure gets on it. And then around the back, I've run another utility rope, Sabre utility rope, around the back of the trailer. And because of this cross member again at the back, I'm hoping that will hold it stiff and pull both sides equally. And we just need to get even 20 mil out of this would be enough to get me out of trouble. All right, that is now nearly straight.
We got clearance.
That's like 10, 15 mil, but when I release this winch, it's gonna go back being steel. So I think I need to go past the point and then release it. But I don't want to break anything like proper. So that's pretty straight there now. That's working good.
I've got about 20 mil on that side clearance. And this side,
you can see it's still twisted. I've got a good 20 mil at the front, 10, 12 mil at the back, so I need to go further. It's actually just dragging the front of the cruiser over. Look at that. There, you can see it's dragged the front of the cruiser. A good 400 millimeters across. But everything's working good.
All right, that's gonna have to be it for now. It's enough to get me out of trouble. I'm hoping I'm just gonna keep pulling over along the way here. I'm just gonna really cruise. It's gonna take me all day probably to get there. And just keep pulling over and checking it, making sure it's not getting worse, making sure that tire's not rubbing. But the last thing I wanna do is pull too hard and actually snap something and then be stuck out here. So let's hit the road. Let's pack this down and hit the road.
Strapped up the axle from the front to help pull it forward, and a strap to pull it back, hold it in position. I've got it on that mounting pin. I've put an extra lock nut on those dodgy bloody U-bolts, and the other side's sweet. I'm gonna take some weight out of the trailer. Whatever I can take out, I'll put the diesel that I've got in there into the truck. I might even take the jerry can out of the boat for the boat, the unleaded, chuck it on the roof rack of the cruiser. Strip some of that weight out and head for Normanton. All right, what happened out there? Well, the day started off amazing, as most mornings do in the Cape, you know. I love hitting those roads early. You know, the shadows are across the road from the trees, the sun's nice and low, there's plenty of wildlife around, you know, I'm looking for bush tucker like you guys saw. And then things just started going wrong, you know, one by one, the bearings, the guard being ripped off, the spring snapping, you know, shredding a tire. And then at the end of the night there, shit just hit the fan. And it's still at that point I hadn't really considered that anyone was going to be worried. I still thought I was going to make it to Jordo. I might have said I'd get there in the afternoon and I'd get there late that night. And it wasn't until, you know, I tore that whole axle out that I realized I'm not getting there tonight and I'm going to be late. But I still didn't think it was going to be an issue, you know, like getting there. It's especially in Cape York, and the amount of time I've spent up there, the roads I've travelled, this has been going on for years and years, right? My wife being used to me going on these adventures. I suppose having kids, you know, having a family changes these things a little bit. So my wife panicked a bit, and I didn't even realise, right? I'm just working through this problem. Okay, how am I going to fix this? And systematically working through it. I got the job done, and it wasn't until I actually got the job done, I actually thought, oh, I've got my spot X, I should turn it on and just send a message out to my wife letting her know that I'm running late, and can you tell Jordo know that I'm going to be there this afternoon? And I turned my spot X on, and it started beeping, going nuts, and there's all these messages from my wife saying, you know, where are you okay, I've alerted the police, people are looking for you, I've told everyone, blah blah blah. And I'm like, oh my God, scrolling through these messages and then trying to type back as quick as I could, trying to get satellite signal, and it took ages. Finally got the message through, got one back saying, you know, okay, but she still didn't believe me. Okay, is, you know, you're going to be able to make it there? Shall I still send help? And I was like, no, it's going to take me about 7 to 8 hours to drive to Normanton from here. I have to limp there. I'll call you tonight. That's when I hit the road and just really limped all the way down there to Normanton.
It is 6:15, the sun's setting out there over the ocean in the Gulf Carpentaria, and I've got 30 kilometres to go. It's taken me about 7 hours today, or 7.5 hours to get from where I slept last night to Normanton, and I'm doing 60 k's an hour now, but all day it was like 40 k's an hour, 30 k's an hour, up to 50, back down to 30, just really taking it easy on that trailer. And I'm so grateful that I'm nearly there. So I don't know what to do from here. I need to work on the trailer. I need to find myself a welder and find myself some springs, get another tire, pull the whole trailer apart and start fixing it and putting it all back together. I'm gonna go pop the tent, crack a beer hopefully, get a steak for dinner, I'll go to the pub, and deal with everything else tomorrow. I'm going to call my wife, I'm in a lot of trouble. I just had like 30 missed calls. Alright.
Alright guys, we're back with another episode. I didn't think it was going to happen, so the last episode was probably all that disaster to the trailer and I'd had enough for season 8, but okay, let's make another episode. We're going to get Jordo. Made it to Normanton. We've got Jordo back on board and I thought I'd make an episode, me showing Jordo how to catch some good barra in this local area here. Yeah. We've got access into a part of the Norman River that I don't think many people come into. Jordo was just saying, obviously over the wet season had a huge flood, all this country went underwater, and some barramundi might have pushed up into this area, we're hoping. There's good looking snags in there, but there's also crocs. The owner just showed us a photo. That was a salty, hey? Looked too big to be a freshie.
I think it was a freshie,
was
yeah.
It? I didn't look at the head.
He had a bit of a narrow snout in
him. Oh, okay. Well, he reckons there is a salty in here. He's seen one, and we just flew the drone and saw a couple of freshies, so heaps of freshwater crocs. And hopefully some barramundi.
David and his dodgy nose. Croc coming up.
Mm-hmm.
sized crocker in there.
How can you not see that?
Is there a croc in the bag?
Over there, yeah. Oh man, that's a croc. It's a monster.
Jordo's gonna jump on him.
All right, well, we're gonna have a move. It just seems dead in there. Not one bite, not even a catfish. But there are crocodiles, which makes you think there should be barra in there, especially if there's saltwater crocodile in there, which we just saw. There should be some barramundi, but there's a bit of a weir apparently downstream here, and that's why this is so still. So hopefully Jordo's gonna take us to the other side of the weir, and we'll put like a dam wall, and get into the actual river itself, chase some barra down there. Because we've only got the day, don't want to waste the whole day just walking here and not actually catching anything. So we're just going to keep moving until we find them.
Yeah, how long ago is that?
Hang on. So Jordo's just saying these rocks here that we're driving, Jordo in the wet season or just after, eh?
Coming to the back end, because we did, the waters came up, and then they started going down for a week there or so, and then they shot back up again.
Okay.
And yeah, pretty much in that point where it went down, we were able to get out here, park our cars up here. This was all underwater.
Wow.
And we were just fishing this big rock that just did.
How crazy is that? So where we're driving is where the barra was sitting.
Three months ago, this was all underwater.
Oh, it's crazy. So that's the difference. To all you international viewers, the top end of Australia, we have the wet season and the dry season. Right now is the middle of the dry, which is like winter, and all the locals get cold.
16 degrees.
It's still stinking hot. And then the wet season is really hot, humid, and super wet, and all these country floods. And like Jordo, who lives up here, it's you get stranded, eh?
Yep.
All right, spot number two. We are way further downstream now. Towards the mouth, this looks like brackish kind of country, looking at the eucalypts and along this water's edge, there's lots of malalucas and stuff around. But still, there should be more fish.
Little rat.
Rat barra?
Yeah.
Yeah, big barramundi in here.
Hey, Jordo right. Saves the day once again.
Finally, we're getting into some spots where it actually looks like there could be some good barra, but I'm yet to see one. We're coming up to some rocks up here, plenty of timber in the water. The water looks like it's moving, so we could be on here. Stick around, don't go anywhere. So today we're fishing, this is Kutan country, and as a lot of you know, Jordo is a Kutan man, he's a traditional owner of this country here, and he's invited me in here to fish with him. So I should explain, if you don't know what I mean by a Kutan country, if you're an international viewer, Australia once had, or still does to this day, but we don't know how many tribes exactly used to be here, but at least 250 tribal nations across Australia. And this area here, this side of this river, and down the coast and out to the east, I don't know how far, but towards Croydon, was owned, the traditional owners of this country, the people who used to walk this country and call this place home, were the Kutan people. So it's an Aboriginal tribe. And still to this day, a lot of them live in this area. Oh, we got some water moving through the rocks here. Look at this. Oh, this is looking epic. Oh, how are we not getting fish?
Right there at my feet.
Nice, mate.
I
wish
I
brought
a
soft plastic in there.
Sorry.
A
little soft plastic would be good.
a little bit better. Yes, we found the barra.
They're all sitting there in that fast water. This is taking us literally all day to find the fish. But it's paid off, hey, like just moving spots, looking for that prime spot being... Oh, look at Jordo's little one. What are you doing over there, Jordo? Look at my monster.
It's quantity, not quality.
Oh, is that a big buff out there?
This is deeper stuff. Where the big girls are sitting.
Oh, it's a big one, Jordo.
Nice, mate. Nice.
But I'll help him with this.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
There you go.
It's a decent one. Oh, so easily could have just given up today. It was like, it's not happening. I think you have to think of the leader for he looks 70 or 60. Yes! Look how fat it is!
Good stuff, mate.
Look how fat that thing is!
What's that underneath him? Oh, that's the leaf.
My god!
I thought we found another parasite.
Oh, look at that. It's done a good job too, both sides. That's a beauty. Absolute beauty. And look at the backdrop. Look at the sort of country we're fishing in. Jordo up there, the Malalukas. Good size barra. That'd have to be a good 68, I reckon, but it's fat, healthy. Oh, mate, I'm stoked with that. Oh, I don't know. Should we keep one, Jordo?
Keeper? Yeah.
All right, we decided to keep this one because it's well and truly size and it's nice and healthy. There's going to be a really good couple of fillets on this, so we'll bleed him. We'll bleed her. Bleed him. And then hanging up in a tree. Thank you, mate. Thank you.
Onto this rock. It's a little bit
of branch.
That branch, sorry. And then onto the rock.
That.
Yeah. He's done it.
Nothing to see here, Mum.
This is going straight in the video.
Jordo's found a croc slide. Oh yeah, coming right up. It's a bit of a swirl around. Yeah. Back down into there. Oh yeah, look at the feet. I'm sure you can claw them. See that? You see the claws on either side of the... Yeah, and down into there. That's a big belly. Big saltwater crocodile. And that's why you always see us when we fish in this country, we're normally back from the edge. Because they'll come out of the water like that. But they won't put themselves at risk either. Like if you're up from the edge and there's three or four people, don't take my word for this, but they, you know, they're not gonna put themselves in danger to get a feed. beer battered Barramundi guys. So I have to apologise to the viewers. This trip's been beer battered Barramundi in Yarrabah, beer battered Barramundi in Ingenue, beer battered Barramundi in Normandon. It's a tongue twister, Jordo.
Yeah, it
is. So yeah, there hasn't been much of a variety of cooking this trip, but I don't know, it's so good. And then once people have had it, like Jordo, it's like you want to have it again, don't you?
Yep.
So I rock up in town, I'm like, right, let's try something different. And everyone's like, nah, let's do the beer batter.
The only thing I would try again actually was that Chinese
the whole one.
Style
yeah. I was thinking when I was carrying the barra today, I was thinking, can we leave it whole and do that? Because I haven't done it since then.
Yeah. It's a bit of a process though.
It is, yeah, and I don't have all the stuff. But yeah, comment below, whatever you guys think. Do you want to see much more of a variety? Do you want me to cook that barra again in the coals with the foil that we put in it, like fish sauce, oyster sauce, all that stuff? Comment below, let us know. How good's that look? Look at that light behind us. This place is absolutely magic. This is Normanton, we're right in town as you can see. Car's about to come past, and out here in front there's magpie geese, there's crocodiles, there's wallabies jumping across, there's a wallaby right there. Just above that aerial there. Little wallabies out there on the flats. There's just wildlife galore. It's an amazing wetland right here in town. So Normanton is near Corumba. If you don't know the area, in the base of the Gulf of Carpentaria. Big white-bellied seagull, look at that. Look at that fella. Oh, he's coming this way. Ah. The kite's giving him a hard time. So that's a huge big white-bellied seagull and two whistling kites up there above him, which are swooping down, giving him a hard time. But yeah, just amazing country. So if you get the chance, come down here to Normanton, because it's spectacular, especially this time of night and then early in the morning when the sky's like this as well. This place just comes alive. During the day, it can be a bit, you know, it's hot and dry and it's the Gulf, you know, so it's cattle country, it's very flat, not a lot of fresh water, but this time of night and in the morning, it's magic. I highly recommend coming in here, saying good day to the locals and having a good look around, chase yourself some Barramundi and just experience this place.
Straight on,
set you guys up.
No. Oh, there you go, you gotta have it now.
Oh no.
Just look at that. So this is hot sauce from Josh over in Yarrabah. What is it? Uncle Mango? Mango Reaper. Heat 9 out of 10. Jordo's favourite. Going home with you, mate.
That's actually
good. Did you just taste a bit?
Yeah, it was a little bit.
Are you alright?
Yeah, nah.
Your face has gone real red.
Really?
No. There he goes.
Tastes good.
Yeah?
Like, you don't want
to. Hasn't killed it.
It doesn't feel good, but it tastes good.
Doesn't feel good, but it tastes good. This is the last episode of season 8, guys, I reckon. I'm heading home after this, back home to see my beautiful family. And this seems to happen a bit, hey, where Jordo is here for the wrap up.
Yeah.
He's whispering, it must be
what? Knock the snot out of me.
Oh, I'm so glad. So if you don't know Dan, this fella here, he's here with us today doing a bit of filming with us, and because he's absolutely amazing on Instagram. His photography is next level. The stuff he does with the drone and the hiking and that is really cool. So go check out his page. Wunez, yeah?
Wunez.
W-U-N-E-Z. Is it Wunez?
Yeah.
Thanks for today, mate.
No worries, mate.
As always.
Good. Always good seeing you, even if we don't, you know, go out on a tinny drift or something. Or...
Yeah. Well, this was different because it was so close to town. Like, this is your backyard, pretty much. It's good. So, yeah, thank you to Jordo. 4 rapid-fire questions.
I've only got 3. I'm sure there's a 4th one.
Favourite lure.
That's one of them. All right, here we go. Rapid fire. Okay. Favourite lure.
Slim Twitcher.
Very good. Biggest barra you've ever caught?
115.
115?
Yeah.
Fresh water?
Salt.
Yeah?
Just over by that big tower over there.
All right, we'll edit that bit out. biggest barra you've caught on wild reaches?
95. 92? We call it 95.
favorite YouTuber?
Yeah, of course.
That's the only question that matters. That's a wrap. Favorite thing about Normanton?
It's got to be the country, the bush, all the rivers. Yeah, I much prefer that over the town.
Yeah, explain that to us and the viewers, because that's something that I get to witness from all the amazing people I meet, that connection to country. Like, and you, a prime example, you've moved to Brisbane, you've lived in Cairns, and you're back here.
Yeah.
What is it?
I don't, it's hard to explain, yeah. Like, I just got to a point where I was missing it too much here, so it's time to come home.
Yeah.
It's like my little safe zone where I come to recharge myself before I go back out into the world.
Yeah, right. Well, that's a wrap for season 8. So, if you're quite new to the show or you don't watch every episode, I met this fella. I got so bogged one trip on the Mitchell River, which is north of here. Took me hours to cross this river and get out, and I finally got out the other side just before sunset, and I was like pulled up, pumping my tires back up, exhausted, and this little car pulls up.
Captiva.
Everyone piles out, and Jordo's like, oh, I watch your show, I like your show.
Yeah.
And we got talking, and he's like, you should come down my country and I'll show you around down there. Yeah. And I was like, oh, I'll see you back in Kawanyama at some stage, because I'm going to be here for a couple of weeks. And then looked for him everywhere, asked everyone, who drives that little green Captiva? And everyone was like, oh, I don't know. So I couldn't find him. And then when I finally got reception, like a month later, we found each other. And now a couple of years now, I suppose. Doing trips, so I'm stoked I met you, mate. And
it was good. Nice to meet you as well, mate.
Thanks for always inviting me back.
Glad I did. Well, thanks for coming back. Give me something to do.
Yeah.
Get me out of work for a while.
That's good. Maybe comment below. What do you want to see me and Jordo do? Where do you want us to go?
Yeah.
That's a wrap for another season, guys. Thank you for watching. You know the deal. Subscribe, get your merch, all that stuff. But go back and watch some of the old episodes. If you missed something from this season, do us a favour and go back and watch a couple of those old episodes. And we'll see you again next season. I'm heading back down the coast now to see my family and going for a men's hunt over on Minjeriba. And I'm going to take all of you for the ride over there. So make sure you stick around for that too. That should be next week. And thanks to Dan for standing there behind the camera. Check out his page too.
This spot looks good.
We'll edit that bit out.
And the first cast.
You know, well, back here, being back at home now with the family and talking this through with my wife and with my son, my parents, Nigel from Adventure Concepts, Johnny from, you know, West Yalanji country, Josh from Yarraba, and plenty of others, all these people that were alerted of what was happening there and were willing to come out and help. Nigel had driven 6 hours up the coast, starting heading out to where people sort of assumed I was going to be. The boys at Yarraba were doing the same, they were about to leave. It was really humbling, you know, to know that I do have so many loved ones out there who care about me and were willing to drop everything and come and help. That's beautiful, but it also made me realize how much I put those people out by not being prepared. You know, my satellite phone broke that trip. At the start of that trip, I took it into a shop in Cairns to get fixed and they couldn't do it. I figured I had the Spot X and I didn't use that to its full capability. And it was really a lesson for me and now for all of you to be prepared in these situations, because that could have gone horribly wrong. You know, my wife's worst case scenarios that were flowing through her mind could have been the reality. You know, me stuck under the trailer, it could have fallen on me, or I might have got swept off the crossing at the Mitchell River, which a few people were thinking. It really could have gone seriously pear-shaped and I would have been on my own. So I've decided now to carry, I've switched across to Zoleo. If you want to know why, I might do a full video on that, maybe the next season, in the next video, because just that they're so simple. They're very, very simple to use and they're cost effective. You know, for less than $400, you've got an SOS button that's going to have help coming straight away. And you can use your mobile phone, the app on your mobile phone, just to type messages to whoever's in your contacts, using your phone, using something that you're already used to using. So I really like this thing. And I highly recommend
you guys, if you're doing anything like what I'm doing, make sure you have all your safety precautions covered. And hang on, I'm sorry to my beautiful wife for putting you through that. It's hard for me to explain to all the viewers what you went through, but I know, and it was torture, and I'm really sorry. To all the wives out there, you probably understand that feeling of just not knowing and having the worst case scenario, those thoughts just running through your mind for hours on end. So I apologize, and I apologize to everyone who was, you know, willing to come and look for me and packing their bags to go and do that, and who had already left, and the station owners who had, you know, told their boys to get cracking and come and look for me. I apologize to all of you, but I also appreciate all of you for being so ready to help. All right, back to it.